Good evening, everyone. How are you doing this evening? Good, excellent. Thank you for joining us tonight at the Ronald Reagan Presidential Library and Museum. My name is Tony Penny, and I am the director of the Walter and Leonore Annenberg Presidential Learning Center. I'm going to give just a couple of opening remarks, and then I'm going to introduce a few other people before we get to our speaker. I wanted to give a little bit, as head of the education programs here, I wanted to give a little bit of context about why we think programs and partnerships like the ones we have tonight are important. So as you are no doubt aware, today is the 13th anniversary of the attacks of 9/11, and while tonight's lecture is about the ongoing legacy of our framers, I've been thinking quite a bit today about the connections between the two. As for 9/11, I remember that day pretty vividly. I was a first-year teacher, and it was the first week of school, and I was sitting in front of a classroom of seventh graders, and all of a sudden I found myself trying to explain to them why the United States was being attacked, and I had no idea. And I tried to find myself, reassure them of everything was going to be okay, even though deep down I had no idea. I was petrified, standing in front of this group of students. Ronald Reagan always said that freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. He said it must be fought for and preserved from one generation to the next. And those of you who know your American history and know all that America stands for know that America's been confronted many times in situations like 9/11. Iraq and Afghanistan, Vietnam, the shores of France, the islands of the Pacific, Gettysburg, the War of 1812, and during the Revolution. Over and over again, there have been assaults on the freedom that we as Americans have held dear since the very earliest days of our country. 9/11 was not the first such attack, and recent history has shown that it probably won't be the last either. But despite these frequent assaults, history reminds us, and I'm going to quote Edward R. Murrow, that we are not descended from fearful men. In fact, we're descended from the bravest, most thoughtful, most innovative group of framers the world has ever known. We're proud to say that we are descended from builders, men and women who imagined a country and a form of government the world had never seen, and a country whose power was derived from we the people. They envisioned this new world, and over the course of a sweltering Philadelphia summer, they built it. And the Constitution is the sturdy frame, the bedrock, and the world's, and this Constitution still thrives 227 years later. Freedom is just as powerful today as it was in 1787. Our curator, Dr. Wolf, is in the audience tonight, and he can tell you that building something is only part of the work. For a country like ours to thrive centuries later means that we've had generations of curators of freedom dedicated to preserving what our framers built. 13 years after the destructive attacks on the World Trade Center, we can see how even in the aftermath of catastrophic destruction, we continue to work to preserve freedom. We remember the victims of 9/11 through memorials, museums, and a new building that has risen from the ashes of the Twin Towers. One World Trade Center is 1,776 feet tall. That number is probably not lost on most of you. A reminder that America has been building and preserving freedom since 1776. Why? Because as Americans, we know that freedom is special and rare, and that it must be preserved and protected by each generation. And we also know that there's more than one way to preserve freedom. The first way that I think most people think of is the tireless and dangerous work of men and women in uniform. They put their lives on the line in the worst and most dangerous corners of the world to preserve our way of life. President Reagan, who knew the value of peace through strength, knew that freedom required tremendous strength of arms, but it also requires tremendous strength of mind. And that's why we're here today, because the second way to preserve freedom is through the ongoing education of children, students, and our citizens. Because no matter how bravely our soldiers fight on the front lines, if we aren't doing our part back home, learning and reminding ourselves constantly of the importance of documents like the Declaration of Independence and the Bill of Rights and our Constitution, and remembering what it means to be an American, we negate the work of our troops and all those who've built this great country. So we must remind ourselves repeatedly what it means to build. And our framers knew this, because the word Constitution itself comes from Latin, and it means to establish and form something new, to build. The preamble, our framers recognized the importance both of building, which we get in order to form a more perfect union, but also its relation to education and educators, because it is important that we secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity. And that's, as an educator, that's my favorite line, our posterity. It's not, education is not something that stops after happening once. It's something that's ongoing. So they knew intrinsically the importance of building and preserving. And we're lucky tonight, I'm not going to say much about our speaker tonight because we have another person who's going to introduce him in just a moment, but we have somebody who knows the work of both building and preserving quite well, who's going to speak to you in just a few minutes. I want to take just a moment to thank our partners in tonight's event. Jason Ross, one of our favorite partners who comes out from time to time for events like these, from the Ashbrook Center at Ashland University. You're going to hear a little bit from him later, but thank you, Jason, for flying across the country. He was actually in Washington, D.C. this morning. That's how important this event was to him. And I also want to thank the Thousand Oaks Republican Women Federated and Rosemary Licata and Beatrice Restifo for all their hard work in putting this event together and for sponsoring the reception. If you liked all the food and beverages, please make sure you thank them. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Beatrice.
Thank you. I call him Anthony, Tony Panay, and I want to ask you all to rise that we will have the pledge to our flag. Face the flag. And in honor of our memories of 9/11 and those that perished and for our military, I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you, everyone. You may be seated. And I'm going to turn the program over to Rosemary to introduce our wonderful speaker, but I want to thank the Annenberg Presidential Learning Center and Anthony and the Ashbrook Center and Jason Ross for the partnership. It's an honor for us to be partnered. And I'd like to thank all the young people and teachers that came and our members and guests. And it was a pleasure to have you come. And I'd like to also thank briefly our wonderful sponsors to help us with the reception, including the Allison's, the Wojcic, and all of the other people that donated to help us with the reception. And I would like to thank the headmaster from Lorena coming and his staff and students and all the other students. And I would now turn the program over to Rosemary Licata to introduce our wonderful speaker. Thank you very much.
Thank you very kindly. It is so wonderful to see teachers, so many teachers here, and so many students. This is one of our educational projects that we do, and it's an honor and a privilege to be partnering with the Annenberg Foundation. Anthony, thank you very much. I call him Anthony. Everybody calls him Tony. But that is unbelievable. And also with the Ashbrook Center from the Ashland University in Ohio. And it gives me great pleasure to introduce the keynote speaker. Professor Gordon Lloyd earned his Bachelor's of Arts degree in Economics and Political Science at McGill University. He completed all the course toward the doctorate and in economics at the University of Chicago before receiving his Master of Arts and and a PhD degrees in government at Claremont Graduate School. The co-author of numerous books in the American founding, so he is an expert, and sole author of a book on the political economy of the New Deal. His latest co-authored books are two narratives of political economy, and The New Deal and Modern American Conservatism, a defining rivalry. He is the creator, now this is very important, he is a creator, with the help of the Ashbrook Center, of four highly regarded websites on the origin of the Constitution. That's his really expertise. He has received many teaching, scholarly, and leadership awards. The main one is the Howard White Award for Teaching Excellence at Pepperdine University at the School of Public Policy. And he was the Licata Lecturer at the Charles and Rosemary Licata Lecture Series at 2014. But he currently serves on the National Advisory Council for the Walter and Leonore Annenberg Presidential Learning Center, the Ronald Reagan Presidential Foundation. So without further ado, we introduce Dr. Gordon Lloyd.
I can turn this on now. Can you hear me? All right, okay. Very good. Thank you, everybody, for coming and spending some time trying to reflect on the origins of the Constitution and what that reflection might mean for us today. A lot of things in life are accidental. A lot of things in life are by choice. And what is an accident, simply by the calendar of the way things happen, is that we today are observing the Constitution, which is 9/17, on 9/11. That was not deliberately planned, but sometimes accidents have a way of encouraging us to reflect on what happens in life. So often we go through life without these opportunities to reflect, but marriages, births, deaths, almost push us to think about who we are and where we're going. So if the tragedy of 9/11 helps us to think through about the blessings of September the 17th, then that accident is well worthwhile. The other thing that we hadn't planned, which is accidental, but very, very pertinent to our discussion, is that 1 week from today, the issue of whether Scotland shall become independent from the United Kingdom, one of the most successful associations in the history of the world, with profound impact, not just for the British Empire, but a whole host of things about which side of the road you drive on. And whether you have your own soccer team. All sorts of implications. But if you think about it, what if Scotland were to disunite? That issue of disunion was on the framers' mind back in 1787. Very often, they used the example of Scotland a mere 70 years earlier as the benefits of a more perfect union. They're not calling for a perfect union. They're calling for a more perfect union, which requires us to examine that where were we before and how are we better off as a result? That's a very, very practical question. It's not one would call an absolutist high moral ground where you don't compromise. It means that being better off is better than being worse off. And you say, well, that's hardly likely to create some kind of fireworks. Good. Good. So how does Scotland enter? We have no idea about what the consequences are going to be when the vote is taken. No idea at all. But what we do know is that the idea that Scotland, England, Wales,
and at that time Ireland united, would have a better chance of surviving in the world, which is full of danger, than England, Scotland, Wales, and Ireland separately, if for no other reason that they wouldn't be fighting each other on the same territory. And Europe and Asia and Africa are full of examples of people fighting each other on the same landmass. And if you can only somehow come united, maybe there is a chance. So 9/11 helps us to reflect. 9/18 raises the question. And 9/17 is what we're talking about today. Of course, you won't find 9/17 in your diary. But nevertheless, it's an important day. Washington himself thought it was an extremely important day. For his farewell address, which he gave in 1796, which he didn't need to give until March, April 1797, he gave on September the 17th, 1796. And Washington was full of symbolism and the idea of the importance of remembering who you are and what you stand for. And he stepped down, he could have lasted a lot longer. But he also decided to announce his before the election took place, that he would not become part of it. But then, why not September the 12th? Why not September the 16th? Why not October the 3rd? September the 17th. It was no accident. That was a choice that Washington made. If we play around this accident and choice issue, it's extremely important. Most countries have come into existence by accident. America consciously came into existence by choice. And it is really, as Reagan pointed out, up to us in a large part whether that choice shall remain. So let me start off with some good news. Every single regime in the history of the world has collapsed. You could only go up from there, right? Every regime has collapsed, right? Including, perhaps, the United Kingdom. Let me bring some other cheery news. Faction, which is war, total disagreement where we don't even want to speak to each other, we won't want to be in the same room or in the same planet. Faction is sown in human nature. So we are quarrelous and contentious beings. So how one could expect perfection out of contentious and quarrelsome human beings is really utopian. So the question we have to ask is, what did the framers know that we don't know? How did they manage to succeed where others have not, previous to them, have not succeeded? And as far as I'm concerned, no one has really succeeded since. The title of the talk bears the supposedly provocative, well, deliberately provocative. It's time to stop blaming our founding fathers. And well, there's a certain sense in which there'll never be a proper time or a perfect time. And it will be your turn to take the blame at some time from your own children or your own grandchildren. And I'm wondering, what will the next generation blame us for in this generation? What have we overlooked that we will take the blame for? So there's a certain sense in which it's virtually impossible to stop blaming our parents or our founding fathers, because faction is sown in our human nature, and somehow life isn't perfect. And so somebody must be to blame for it, that our life is not as good as what it should be. Of course, we encourage that a lot these days. You are not at fault. Now, the question, of course, is why should we be even thinking about blaming the founding fathers? Didn't they accomplish something that the world had never accomplished before? And that is getting 55 people from various backgrounds in the same room, quarreling and contentious, talking about a more perfect union. And after 4 months, they came up with an arrangement and then submitted it to the people for ratification, and not a drop of blood was spilt. Isn't that something worth thinking about? What's the blame in that? It also seems that there's something within the American character that seeks this perfection. And so that in a certain way, we will never stop blaming our parents. And we will never stop saying, I will do for my children what my father or mother never did for me. I'll show them. They got divorced, not me. I'm not going to do it. Dad, I'm getting a divorce. It happens. Divorce. The only difference is back in the olden days, it was fault divorce. We declared independence from Britain, and here's King George's fault. Here he is naughty, 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 naughty. Okay, today, man, I just want to move on. I don't have to say, I just want to reinvent myself. So I don't even, got next. And I'll be 2.5 and next. That's your day in court. But at one time, you had to make a choice. And you have to back it up by arguments. Today, I fear we don't have to do that. Okay. So the good news, which I want us to build on, is never before in the history of the world has 55 people sat in a room and worked this out. And having to work with the nature of human nature. And we're talking about blame. Now, one of the interesting things that I heard with Angela, my wife, we were going to Santa Monica the other morning, and Dennis Prager was on. And Dennis Prager was talking about the problem in England, where there were Pakistanis who were holding English girls hostage and selling them to sex slavery, et cetera. And isn't that terrible? But his point is that the media and the political pundits have given up on the concept of evil. That's evil. But people have given up on the concept of evil, and all they talk about these days is race, gender, and class. It could be. But I would like to go a bit beyond Dennis Prager. There is an element of that goes on. That is sort of make love, not war. But there's also an element of the academy and in the politics, which on the left, which says make war, not love. And evil has not gone away. That is, good and evil has not simply gone away and replaced by do your own thing. That is one part. That's one part, which would be very forgiving of the framers. They didn't know any better. Your fathers didn't know any better. They're irrelevant. They're dead. But there's no nastiness involved in that. They just, my parents, they didn't know anything. They just, you know, they didn't know what to do. Today we do. You know, we're cool. Whatever. But this other feature which I want to mention, which is that make war, not love, does take evil seriously. And that the critique of the founding, the critique of the founding fathers, is not that they're so much irrelevant, but you have two choices. They're either hypocrites, or they're downright nasty. So all the good stuff that I've introduced, and all the good stuff that somehow is out there for our retrieval, gets submerged within this framework of a resurgence of evil. For example, we are a commercial republic. And the whole idea of a commercial republic is that through competition, self-reliance emerges and liberty emerges. Well, if you want to take the commercial republic to its fullest, you could actually say that the sin of the commercial republic is greed. I mean, that's all around us today. The idea of the capitalism or the commerce is that it is greed. Now, if you take a look at that as one of the seven deadly sins, the opposite to that is the virtue or the heavenly virtue of charity. But you can't be charitable unless you have something with which to be charitable. And so that the same time that the critique or the blaming of the founding fathers for introducing a system that ultimately would emphasize greed is that, okay, that might be a runaway feature, but it is not systemic because we are the most charitable country in the entire world. so that maybe the correct solution is not either or, it's either greed or charity, but is it possible to be American? That is, have a bit of both, a mixture, self-interest rightly understood. Take a look at the universities. Take a look at my university, Pepperdine. George Pepperdine was a businessman and a Christian. He doesn't see a clash between those two concepts. And yet, there is this notion that making money is somehow part of a great problem that needs to be fixed. And America's founders created that. What I'm trying to say is they created a commercial republic, but it didn't necessarily create greed. The other thing is that one of the seven deadly sins is wrath. That's where the blaming comes in. The real blame is that there's anger. And the solution to that deadly sin is patience. Now, that puts the issue right at the heart. That's how can I tolerate something which is wrong? How can I tolerate somebody who doesn't agree with me? Why should I put up with somebody who owns a slave? Why should it matter to me whether my neighbor has zero drinks, one drink, or nine drinks? How much am I prepared to be tolerant? Does it matter to me whether my neighbor has zero abortions, one abortion, or nine abortions? How prepared am I to be tolerant? Does it matter to me whether my neighbor has zero slaves, one slave, or nine slaves, or 100 slaves? How prepared am I to be tolerant? With liberty, you get tolerance. But with tolerance, you get imperfection. And so that, in a nutshell, is the problem. If your moral fiber is absolutist or prohibitionist, you will not be content with the framers. You will constantly blame them for falling short. In fact, they would love instead to be called hypocrites. Hypocrites is where say one thing and do another. But if you're an istist, that is a racist or a sexist or a classist, you know full well what you're doing. It's not that you're a hypocrite. You just don't accept the other race or the other class or the other gender as on the same level as you. That's the blaming game. That is, the framers weren't up to the real task of life. And so you look at the color of their skin or whatever it is, and you therefore reflect on what the words that they say and the constitution which they come up with is simply a reflection of the way they are made up physically. Okay? That is corrosive, absolutely corrosive. And fortunately, there are more people who want to come to the United States than leave the United States. And the people who want to come to the United States don't believe a word of it. I came to the United States. I was absolutely surprised when I came here, the extent to which a whole bunch of Americans, especially intellectual Americans, feel ashamed about this country. I just couldn't understand it. Not at all. And it's almost like you have to be perfect. Now, the one thing, before I get into the website, let me just say, the one thing that I find impressive about this critique is that none of us are without blame. And therefore, we do something wrong. And we will be held responsible, or should be held responsible. But the problem is, if you follow that route, there is no room for compromise. Compromise becomes a dirty word. There is no role for practical wisdom. Plato was a perfectionist. If I can't find a perfect regime, it ain't worth doing. I'd rather just be left alone. Many people have tried to create this perfect regime, but it hasn't lasted, not even in speech. And part of the reason is because you cannot transform human beings because they're not perfect. We quarrel and we are contentious. Then there are mere politicians who just want to get us out of a situation. And then there's old Aristotle, who said that the art of politics is not just the art of the possible, it is the art of the best possible. And I think the framers ought to be looked at in that light. That is, what is the best that is possible within the framework that we are? We cannot start, even though it's a founding, there's something prior to the founding. There's a colonial history. Cannot start all over again, but we can start as close to being all from the start again. And then we can set in motion. Correct. Cannot settle right at this particular moment. That is statesmanship. That is practical wisdom. That is prudence. Today, we seem to think that practical wisdom, prudence, compromising, is kicking the can down the road. That is, we're not facing up to our problems. But politics at its best is not problem solving. Politics at its best is issue settling, particularly if you're dealing with a diverse number of people coming from a variety of backgrounds. How the heck are you going to get? Do you know how difficult it was to put this Constitution together? How can we possibly expect in the 20th and 21st century that you're going to put a bunch of Kurds, a bunch of Sunnis, a bunch of Shiites together and say, have an inclusive government, and it'll have to happen within the next 2 years? There is no understanding of the difficulties of founding. Somehow, it's easy. It's not easy. Well, that's enough of sort of what I want to do is in terms of a lecture. That is, it is time to stop blaming our founding fathers. Just as somewhere along the line, when we get to be 30 or 40, we ought to stop blaming our own parents and take care of our own life. And maybe we have to wait until our own parents are dead before we do that. But somewhere along the line, we have to be able to govern ourselves. And in any system that sets up for governing ourselves, the parents can't take care of everything. They can bring you into life, they can set up the mechanism, but they can't do everything for you. And it is downright silly for children or teenagers to expect that and to be so self-righteous, excuse me, that because they are, self-righteous about the ease with which parenting should be, as if they feel abandoned, as in the wonderful words of Joan Rivers, oh, shut up. All right. What I want to do with you now, given you that sort of background, is say, I'm not here to blame the founding fathers. I'm here to praise them. And what I want to do is to show you the reason why, how to go about doing this. There are four websites, and one of the websites deals with the Constitutional Convention. Can you still hear me when I go over here like this? Yeah. Okay. Jason is the invisible man in the back. If you were to go to the convention, and let's pull it out and see what options we have at the convention. Yeah, you know, learn more is a good start. All right. Well, that's no. Could we get out of that one? All right. That's it. The Constitutional Convention is an in-depth study of how the Constitution was created. Okay. The three other websites indicate how the Constitution was ratified by delegates selected, how the Constitution was debated by the Federalist Papers and the Anti-Federalist Papers. And the fourth one shows how the Bill of Rights came into existence. You put all four together, you have the narrative of the founding. Tonight, in honor of Constitution Day, and in honor of not blaming our framers, let us examine what they managed to accomplish in the creation of the more perfect Union. September the 17th is the last day, but it's an important day because they all sat around and said, you realize we have not created the perfect system. I think Great. So what do they end on? They end on a conversation. And that is what Democratic Republican politics should be. We have a framework. It is not that we shut up our disagreements, but we have an understanding of what the limits of human brain and the human will can accomplish. So there's an introduction to this. In order to make this sensible, I hope, in order to make this sensible, if we click on in this section, in the convention, you know what? I was given this deliberately. If you go there, that'll solve a whole bunch of problems, won't it? If we go there and click on, right? What I've tried to do is to encourage citizens, scholars, students to be able to become interested in what the framers say. I mean, look, you can't blame them really, seriously, until you've read them. And on the other hand, you can't praise them seriously until you've read them. But it is difficult to read. One reason is because it's difficult for us to read today. Who reads? So one of my tasks as a teacher is to try to make this material available in readable form without dumbing it down. That is, I'm not going to, when somebody asks me, could you please put the Federalist Papers in 21st century language? Absolutely not. Forget it. Well, what can you do? It must have been written for elites and upper class twits. Well, there's a difference between twits and twitters. But even if it were, but of course it wasn't. They weren't written for upper class twits. It was written for people who know how to read and write. Right, and that reading and writing was pretty well widespread. But what I can do, and what I am prepared to do, is to try to make it more manageable for you to talk to the framers and the framers to talk to you. How do I do that? I take James Madison seriously. How can I take James Madison's account? He spent 40 years on writing this, from 1787 until he died in 1836. He spent 40 years writing this. Aha! He must have altered it along the way. He must have done it to make himself look good. What kind of conspiracy did he come up with? Why, if I read, it says they met from 9 o'clock in the morning until 4 o'clock in the afternoon. If I take a stopwatch and I read what Madison has to report on day three, I'm only reading an hour. So he hasn't reported everything that was said. Aha! I can't really then rely on Madison. I can't rely on anybody. How can I even rely? Since we don't know what the framers said, how can we even praise them? All the better to blame them, my dear. Well, the point is that Madison is not a clerk. He is not intended to be a court reporter. He is not there with a stopwatch and a stenographer's talent to write everything down. In fact, in 2 days, Luther Martin, also by the nickname of Luther Martini, would talk on and on and on, and Madison got so ticked off, he said, Luther Martin did go on and on in a rambling style. Now, he spent 5 hours one day and 5 hours the next day, and Madison has it written down in 2 pages. Why? Because the man was drunk. And then you all knew what he was going to say, and they all knew beforehand what he was going to say, and so you could summarize it in one paragraph. So I don't need to have a stopwatch. I don't need to be a court reporter in order to report on the debates of the convention. And that's one huge, shall we say, element of trust that I ask you to join me on, because without that, what I'm about to do is it won't work. Okay. All the better to try to capture that. I've divided the convention into the four-act drama. Act one, laying down the plans, the alternative plans. Somebody came up with the idea of having this as our plan. We go through it. Then we have a second discussion of it. Somebody doesn't like this, somebody doesn't like that. They vote on it. They have their arguments. All right? What? How seriously do you take a vote? And as if it's 9-3, do the three people walk out of the room? Do the three people say, well, maybe this is not the time to be able to persuade you, but later on I can persuade you. Let's just see how things go. Do you have the patience? Do you have the stamina to withstand what it takes to go through the dynamic of a long-term conversation? Think about labor negotiations in the National Football League or in the National Hockey League, or any situation with people behind closed doors talking about, behind closed doors. Nobody goes behind closed doors and keeps things in secret unless they want to shaft you, my dear. That's what they did. Curtains drawn. Secret proceedings. Up to no good. Blame them. You can go through this, and people are coming up with resolutions. Decision day. So you have talking, and you have deciding. A decision is made. Okay. It looks like Madison is having his way with some of the main features of the Virginia plan, which is moving us toward much more of an intercontinental arrangement. Remember, there was no such thing as an American. Not until the war, 1776. We're all in. So the question is, how do you, here's a task. How do you create a new identity, an American, without at the same time undermining the identity to which you are used to which you are used? That is namely being a Virginian. How do you create a free trade area from Boston to Georgia in which you don't have to pay taxes at every or show a passport, or pay a tariff? How do you do all of that and still remain a Georgian? The European Union is still fighting over it. It's a huge issue, which requires discussion, compromise, particularly if you've got 55 people from different backgrounds, different things. In other words, think about it. Before the founding, before 1787, every founding that took place was done by one person. Solon, Theseus, Moses, whatever. But never by 55 people sitting down in a room and arguing or discussing. There were rules. Nobody shall talk twice until everybody has had the opportunity to talk. At least look alert. Don't fall asleep. Right? Turn off your cell phones. So we enter Act Two, and we think, all right, so Madison is on track. He's had to compromise. He's had to compromise. Did he want to compromise? No. But there's a reality, a practical reality. 55 people in a room, do you want to move forward or not? I want to move forward. What is the best possible I can do? I don't blame people for doing the best that they can do under the circumstances. I do blame people for slothfulness. I do blame people for being full of wrath. I do not blame people for doing the best they can with what they have, and hopefully we can learn from that, since maybe, just maybe, they have something to teach us. Interestingly, in terms of the dynamic, the people who weren't doing as well gathered their forces and dug in and refused to budge. And so you get a deadlock in the entire system. And that's the tedious part of going through these debates, because you say, what progress is being made? Come on, flip it, right? Come on, let's get but understand the dynamic of conversations and negotiations. It requires sticking it out when times when you don't want to be there. The only delegation that was there for every single day was South Carolina. I mean, in its entirety. And that gave South Carolina a sort of a leverage which other states did not have. If you're there all the time, you become, well, knowledgeable. A compromise is reached. What is the compromise? A compromise, by the way, the vote was virtually 6-5. Why was that? Well, it wasn't 13th. Rhode Island never showed up. Rhode Island never showed up. New Hampshire hadn't arrived yet. New York left in disgust. All of those things show you the dynamics and the difficulties of putting together a constitution or nation building, for goodness sake. But they made a compromise. What compromise? Compromise that a certain delegates wanted a loose intercontinental alliance, and they wanted strong state and local communities. The other group, who were younger, like Madison, wanted a stronger, more robust, more perfect interstate community in which it was based on, quote, we the people rather than we the states. How can you compromise on that? Good question. Secondly, how can you call a 5-4-1 vote a compromise? Doesn't sound like a compromise to me. That sounds like a 5-4-1 vote. The compromise is a third way, very American. Think out of the box. Why must I be bipolar? It's either this or that. Why can't it be a third way? That's entrepreneurship. That is one of the reasons why the founders are worthy of respect. That is there a way in which we can settle this issue in a principled fashion without giving up principle, but at the same time understanding that if we were to create a union and keep a union, we have to give. And we're not talking about weakness versus strength. We're talking about human beings engaged in negotiation. So what happened? The agreement was the House, which, by the way, the framers did not call the lower branch. The first branch, they call it. The House would be based on the people through census, elections, and districts, etc. The Senate, which they did not call the upper branch or the upper house, they call it the second branch, will be based on the states. So the compromise is we are a nation of people and a nation of states. How the heck are you going to pull that one off? That the world had never seen that before. Well, that requires statesmanship. That requires people who come after them to either amend the Constitution so it goes one way or the other, or to try to keep the balance. The problem within America is that about 1845, two sides emerged which were unwilling to deal with that settlement. One side wanted disunion through states' rights and secession, the Southern Confederacy. The other side wanted disunion by not having anything to do with the covenant with the devil and slavery, William Lloyd Garrison, who was very much in favor of disunion, which means that faction took over and there's this huge split between the sides in which the Union could not survive. That became Lincoln's task. How do you, and anybody who's going to try to do that is going to get blamed from both sides. One side is going to blame you for overreach, and the other side is going to blame you for not reaching far enough. And that's the government. So if we're looking to the framers for some tablet in which everything we need to know is written on it, you won't find it. What you will find from the framers is an understanding of human nature, how difficult it is to frame, how you have to try to do the best that you can. And every generation faces that problem, which is why civic education becomes the real issue for me, not just civic engagement. It doesn't really concern me whether people are not as animated as they used to be to go out and vote. What bothers me is they don't know the faintest thing about their own country, or they don't care to know about their own country and how it is, but rather they blame it or neglect or say that we've been neglected or to heck with our framers, they're dead, they're irrelevant. Well, Thank goodness that you're smart and they're not. Because you too will die. And what are they going to say about you? Do you care about you, what you've managed to contribute to this story? So there's a compromise. And then there's an intermission. And you say, now, Lloyd, you're really going too far in trying to make this thing. You have an intermission. What is this, a Shakespeare play? In a sense, yes. Shakespeare's Richard II, his whole reign could not have taken place in 2 hours. Right? It's true, Plato's Republic, you can read in about 8 hours, and it probably did take 8 hours of drunken youthfulness to get through all night to do Plato's Republic. But most works of art and literature depicting the life and times of, you don't need the stopwatch. You've got the story, for goodness sake. So an intermission took place, and a committee of detail met. Five people were selected. One from Massachusetts, you have to. Massachusetts, the state for the revolution. One from Virginia, you had to. Virginia took the lead. One from Pennsylvania, why, you had to. Pennsylvania is Philadelphia, the historic city, the place. You got to do that. One from Connecticut. Why? Because they're the ones who compromise. And one from, well, fill in, you don't want four people, you have to have five. On this particular time, they chose one from a delegate from South Carolina, who, before the committee met, said, if the delegates have any mind whatsoever in getting rid of slavery, South Carolina will not sign. Now, there you have not statesmanship, you have playing a card and playing the brinkmanship. The committee on detail made its report. And the month of August was taken up debating every single clause. The clause that caused the most consternation of all was the slavery clause, dealing with the importation. And I can go on, but the point is that to say that there was no discussion, to say that there was nothing going on, is a complete misreading of the text and the story. Act four, the end is in sight. The Brearley Committee also has the undelicate title, the Committee of Leftovers. And one of the great leftovers was how do you deal with the presidency? Well, some people say, well, I can't deal with the presidency until I know there's going to be one president or two presidents. I can't answer that unless I know how long the president is going to be in office. I can't deal with that whether I know the president is going to be re-eligible for office or re-electable. Well, I can't deal with that unless I know the president is going to be impeached. I can't deal with that until I know how the president is going to be elected. And I can't deal with that unless I know there are going to be one or two presidents. And so, how do you break the circle? How do you enter a conversation which is going nowhere? So the dynamic is you need some degree of leadership to break that. And the Brearley Committee's job was to break that. And what was the answer? The Electoral College. That's why the Electoral College came. You read textbook after textbook. Electoral College demonstrates that the framers did not like the people. They were elitist. They were smug. It was such and such and such and such. Where do you get this nonsense from? Well, because you don't read and write. That's the reason why you get it. Then you have the Committee on Style report. Five people on the Committee on Style. One from Massachusetts. One Pennsylvania. One Virginia. One Connecticut. And one leftover, this time New York, Hamilton. And they signed the Constitution. And they declared that they have created a more perfect union. And the question throughout the centuries has been, is this good enough? Is this good enough to have created a more perfect union? Or must we, excuse me, hold the framers responsible for not hold them responsible for creating the Electoral College. Hold them responsible for having separation of powers. Hold them responsible for having two chambers, one of which represents the states. Hold them responsible for having voting at age 21 rather than 12. Hold them responsible for, you name it, bam, 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 bam. And I say you do the best you can with what you've got. And if that's not good enough, don't be a parent. I mean, right, say, I'm better off not having a child. And you could, and the children grow up and they can amend it, for goodness sake. Now, Tony, I'm looking at you. And the reason I'm looking at you is not because you're a parent. I'm looking at you because you're a very happy parent with three children, right?
Yes.
That's right. And the little one is now about three.
14.
14, all right. They grow up fast. Faster than you think. I am wondering whether I should, I mean, there are a whole bunch of other things that I can show. But I'm wondering whether people want to ask questions, whether I should go on, say, for 5 more minutes and then open it up. That's a good compromise, isn't it? It's a practical wisdom, sensible solution. I am your most humble and obedient servant. I'm your subject. I'm not a citizen. Jason, if we go back to the main page, please. The delegates. Just if you click on delegates. Yes. Names, ages, education, experiences, biographies. All right. I want to look at, say, 2 points. A number of, if you scroll down, please, you can see. It tells you the age of the delegates. The average age was about 43. It is true that in those days, the life expectancy was about 43, 44. But we have this perception that these were old guys with wooden teeth, and they were out of touch. If not with us, certainly out of touch with themselves. But one of the things I have found is that within American politics and the American conversation, there's a generation gap. Regardless of whether it's the 1920s or 2014, there's a definite generation gap. And if you just hit the age of the delegates for a minute, I keep saying hit, bad word, click on. All right, 4 of them in their 20s. Here are the people in their 30s, including but not limited to Gouverneur Morrison, James Madison, and Alexander Hamilton, the movers and shakers, people in their 40s, and then into their 50s. These become the more moderate people, the people who are willing to shake things up and take a risk with the people in their 30s, regardless of whether they came from a small state or a large state, regardless of whether they were slaveholders or not slaveholders, the people who are more cautious. Well, let's not go too fast. Let's such and such and such, slow things down. We'll let experience be our guide, all that kind of thing. But people who are older, of part of the former generation, there is a generational conversation that takes place within the founding that I think is extremely valuable for us to recover as Americans, younger Americans talking to older Americans. If we go back, you can play all around us, and you want to go and find out what their biography is, you just click on that. And it shows who James Wilson is and what he's doing, what he's up to, et cetera. If you go back, please, Jason, to go back one more, please. Yes, educational background. Well, if you click the educational background, you'll find that who went to school. I mean, in those days, getting an undergraduate degree, you had to do some work. It was not all about self-esteem. And it certainly was not about being a student athlete. This is about learning the classics. But look at Princeton. Princeton is a perfect example of what you might call going out of state to go to college. That is, a lot of people from Massachusetts went to Harvard. A lot of people from Virginia went to William and Mary. University of Virginia had not been created yet. That was Thomas Jefferson and James Madison created that in the early 19th century. But people from all across the nation went to Princeton, including James Madison from Virginia. In other words, they had some experience with each other from out of state, and it's not going too far. In fact, I would think it's even more of an impact back then than it is now, that when you go out of state, you hear different accents. You hear different, it takes a while to get there. You just can't turn around and come back. People invite you to their home. They invite you to such and such, their own little customs. And so you learn from each other. You learn, right? How can you build an intercontinental union, a more perfect union, if you have a union of people who don't know each other or are not well enough educated in order to, oh, but that means they're elites. Excuse me, everyone in this room is an elite. It may not mean you're upper class, but you're hopefully decently educated and curious. That's elite. Most of the world aren't curious. That's why serfdom exists for so long. They're not curious. Just tell me what to do. Go back again to another category, please. The continental experience of the delegates. I'll end on this one. Who signed the Declaration of Independence? There you go, 3, 6, 8. Who served in the Continental and Congress? Look at them, that's where they had to deal with each other. Who served, who had experience writing their own state constitutions between 1776 and 1780? So that they had experience writing constitutions and what worked and what didn't work. Look at them all. Including, at that time, 25-year-old James Madison. And we could go on and on. I don't find as much to blame there. I find as much to praise there. There is a mixture of intelligence and with youth. That's lethal. And those who are intelligent but older can get away by lying. Those who are younger but not as intelligent can get away because they're swift. But what do you do with people who are intelligent and swift? Why is it that 19th century Germany created some of the greatest classical music in the history of the world? Why is it that these folks, I can't answer that, but there are certain accidents that happen in life in which if you don't take advantage of that opportunity, it's gone forever. It's gone. Let me do one last point and then take some questions. If we go back to the, let's get out of this, please. I want to end, there's so much I can do. I want to end on a map of Philadelphia. Let's just take a look at the map of Philadelphia and end with George Washington's entertainment. Okay, Jason? Okay. Take a map, look at the map of Philadelphia. Whoops. We won't be taking a look at the map. See, are you on safari? Firefox? No, I've had this before. There are certain computers or certain programs that don't have it. Or you have it there? No, sorry, can't do it. It's not coming up tonight. So what I want to do then is to end with George Washington's farewell dinner. I think it's under resources. Scroll down, please. Oh, that's fine. Yeah, all right. Let's just keep it there at the moment. Right, the whole point of this exercise, not just tonight, but what I've been working on, the whole point is this. This is not necessarily a sales pitch at all. It's just telling you how proud I am. This is the debates of the Federal Convention of 1787 by James Madison, a member. This is what James Madison wanted. This is as closest as what James Madison wanted to leave behind. It is literary. There are no shorthand. This is what he wanted to leave behind. It's taken me a long time to put it together, but this is the ultimate reason for me putting this website together. That is, through aid, through summaries, through photos, through this, through that, and the other. I want you not to memorize. I want this to become part of your soul. And that's the objective. But I want to end on a sort of a light note. I am one of the things about American life, which is always amazed me, is the role of moral equivalence in life that Americans seem to suggest. And the press pushes this so that somebody does something, oh, that's the moral equivalent of slavery, or that is the moral equivalent of such and such. Now, I can get on board and say, yeah, it's wrong for me to own another person. That's slavery. That's wrong. I do care whether my neighbor owns one slave or not. But why is the abolition or the prohibition on slavery becomes the moral equivalent of the abolition and the prohibition of alcohol consumption in your own room, in your own house? That's what happened in the 1880s and into the early 1900s, that the prohibitionist movement, the progressive movement, and its prohibitionist policies considered drinking to be the moral equivalent of slavery. Okay. One of the things I can assure you of is that the framers did not suffer from a problem of abstention with regard to alcohol. And if there's any generation, any era of American life in which you invited them, please come back and see whether you recognize this time or not. The time they would not recognize is the Prohibition era. There are 55 gentlemen. This is for George Washington's farewell party, right? 54 bottles of Madeira, 60 bottles of claret, 8 bottles of old stock, 22 bottles of porter, 8 bottles of cider, 12 bottles of beer, 7 large bowls, spelling was not their strength, bottles of punch, cigars, spermaceti candles, etc., wine glasses and tumblers broken, yay, yazoo, to 16 servants and musicians, don't forget them, after all men are created equal. All work is honorable. 16 servants and musicians' dinners, 16 bottles of claret, 5 bottles of Madeira, 7 bowls of punch. Price, £89, 4 shillings and tuppence. And I had a guy work that out for me, and it turns out in 2011, it would have been $15,400 for that dinner. And then the bill for the musicians. Bill for the musicians. George Christliff, £1. Mr. Jones, £1. Mr. Turner, £1. John Kaiser, 15 shillings. Philip Grote, 15. David Kotstruck, 15. John Brunner, 15. Konrad Spakenberg, 15. Where do these Germans come from? I got a letter from George Christliff the 17th or whatever, and he said, what do you know about my 17th grandfather removed or whatever? I said, no, only what you're gonna tell me about him. He said, well, yeah, I'm the genealogist. So I learned that all of these people were in fact mercenaries hired by King George the III from Germany to fight against the Americans in the War of Independence. And in the peace treaty, and they were in prison, and in the peace treaty of 1783, ending the war, there was an exchange of prisoners. These guys didn't want to go back to Germany. They wanted to stay in America. And they created Germantown. And these folks, can you imagine, 4 years after the end of the war, they're playing and drinking at George Washington's farewell. How can you blame the framers?
I think we have enough time for a couple of questions. Does anybody have any questions for Dr. Lloyd before we have some books? If anybody,
oh,
we have a question. Oh, here we go.
What makes me passive?
What makes you so passionate? That's a good question.
Blame my parents. Favorite founding father would be James Madison. But James Madison would be the first to remind you that there are many founders involved and that it would be erroneous to treat James Madison as the father or the founder, like Moses or such and such, that it is a collective act in by many, many people. What gives Madison a degree of authority is that he was 5'2", 120 pounds, always dressed in black because he thought he was going to die any minute. He outlived everybody, okay? So that he becomes the father of the Constitution because he outlives everybody. Plus, he's the person who wrote the notes or the debates. And so when we think of the founding, we think of James Madison. But James Madison is not the only one. That's why he's my favorite. Not because of what he is as a doer, but because of because he chronicled. Yes, he wrote it down. Good question.
Dr. Lloyd, I don't have a question, but I want to remind the students and teachers that Pepperdine University has donated a constitution for them to take home. So that would be very nice, and they should have your book available in the rear if they would like to purchase that.
Thank you. All purchases go to the James Madison Fund.
Dr. Lloyd, thank you for your talk. I'm Michael Bates, the head of school at Lorena. Your emphasis on compromise is so apropos to this moment. What's going to move our Congress, our government, towards compromise? The inspiration of the founding fathers or something greater?
Well, I would hope that the inspiration of the founding fathers would be sufficient because I don't know how much greater one can go and still remain within the American context. I think that one of the things that has to happen is that members of the House and Senate consider themselves to be members of the House or Senate first, rather than Republican or Democrat. In other words, the way to create bipartisanship is to reduce the incentive and the attraction of being partisan. And so instead of saying that I'm a US senator, why don't I just say I'm a Democrat or I'm a Republican from such and such? But what does it mean to be a senator anymore? A senator is supposed to do things. A member of the House is supposed to do things. Look at the controversy over the judiciary. The judiciary, it really doesn't matter to me whether it's Republicans or Democrats. They're all acting some kind of partisan manner. And I think political parties have had a huge role to play in the creation of the controversies which we take. And compromise has come to be a very bad word. That is, somehow we are taught, either by reading too much Thoreau, too much Emerson, too much Kant, too much of all of that, that somehow if something is right, I must act on it completely, otherwise I'm a hypocrite, or I don't truly believe in what I stand for. Well, whatever happened to prudence? Whatever happened to the notion that, yes, this is right, but you know what? This is not quite the time and place to put it. We tell our children that all the time. And what do our children tell us? They blame us. They blame us for being cowards, or they blame us for being hypocrites. They do not see the what we need to do is to show politicians and our youth that there is some human dignity to bending without breaking. Yes, yes, favorite student of all time.
Oh, thank you.
If I
were teaching this question of slavery, which the students, this hypocrisy question of slavery, if you could give me the two best reasons why the founders handled it the way they did, I only have two opportunities to explain. Like, these are the two best reasons. What would you say? Right, yep, compromise, yep. I understand the compromise part, but I mean, I think it's deeper than
well,
that.
One premise that you have to start with is, to what extent is a union of the 13 states a vital part? If you look at the preamble, it's we the people, right? But notice, it doesn't say we the people, it says we the people of the United States. That shows you the compromise right there. It doesn't say we the states, and it just doesn't say we the people. It's we the people of the United States. And it doesn't say we make a perfect union in order to make a more perfect union. If you accept that premise as a legitimate premise, then slavery gets mixed into it. It's something to be compromised. The question for me is not whether they could abolish it immediately, but did they put slavery on the course of ultimate extinction? Before 1787, the Union did not have any control over abolishing slavery. Okay? So the first time that they had anything was this convention. So one first answer to you is if they didn't abolish it, which they didn't, did they set a framework? Because framers are builders, framers are not closers. Framers don't lay carpet, framers put up frames. So did they put a frame in place that the next generation could continue the work which they did? And the answer is yes. And what proof would I give you? Out of the Committee on Detail report, we get the premise that slavery, that Congress henceforth shall never be able to do anything whatsoever for any day in the rest of eternity about the slave trade. Both sides understood if you stop the slave trade, the next step is stopping slavery. If you permit the slave trade, the next step is that you permit slavery. So they may be wrong, but their understanding is both sides understood the slave trade. So what did they do about the slave trade, Article 1, Section 9? And the answer was, coming out of the Committee on Detail, it was Congress can do nothing forever. That created controversy. Madison and others got the delegates to consider Congress shall do nothing to 1800. So a compromise occurred. How about 1808? And so the question is 1808 closer to 1800 and now? And my answer would be yes. Is that a perfect answer? No. Would I have preferred 1800? Yes. Would I have preferred now? Well, I'm not quite so sure, because one of the disgusting features of African slavery in the South is that they weren't taught how to read and write. And how do you free people who can't read and write in a republic that requires you to read and write? So some kind of Head Start program or reconstruction program has got to be put in place right away. So that's one answer I would give. Second answer I would give is that so much attention had been given by the time 1845 arrived, you've got both Lloyd Garrison on the one side, and you've got Judge Taney and Stevens on the other, saying that we can blame the founders. In fact, the blaming game of the founders in many ways starts in 1840s. And it continues. And it starts with Taney saying, and also Stevens saying, that the Declaration of Independence is a self-evident lie, that blacks were not intended to be equal to whites, and therefore the Fugitive Slave Clause is the most important clause in the entire Constitution. But in fact, it took them no more than like a day and a half, and it was an add-on. Garrison saying virtually the same thing, that Isaiah such and such says, covenant with death, covenant with such and such. And we have to blame the founders for making a deal with the devil. Okay? In other words, both sides are in fact accusing the framers, not of hypocrisy. Both sides are accusing the framers of being racist. One side likes it, the other side doesn't. And that is the ultimate crisis for me about the war, the years leading to the Civil War. And you cannot have compromise if one side is calling you racist, the other one is saying, yes, I am, and I love it. I mean, you can't cut a deal. Well, how about if I'm half racist? I took a course the other day called Racism, and I got an A. Or should I have got an F? Okay?
We have enough time for one last question. I will let you choose the questioner.
Oh, yeah, you're so sweet to me. I saw two hands up. So if you can behave yourself, I can fit you in, and I want to fit you in because you like me.
So I'm curious what you think happens if New York or Massachusetts during that ratification debate, if they just flip a couple votes, what happens next?
If
in either Massachusetts or New York or Virginia, if just a couple votes shifted.
I think you leave New York to one side. I think you're absolutely right. Massachusetts is critical. Virginia is critical. New Hampshire is critical. If they don't switch those two couple votes, the Constitution doesn't get ratified, or it gets ratified without Massachusetts and Virginia in it. And what kind of union do you have? So you had to compromise. And what was the compromise? Ratify now, and I will do whatever I can in the first Congress to see whether or not we can come up with a solution that you can buy into. And the answer was there were some people. First person, what's that?
Sounds like Obama.
Well, and there's certain.
Just go ahead and let us do it, and later we'll try and fix it.
Well, but that's being a bit cynical with regard to the framers. Nancy Pelosi and James Madison in the same place? but the point is well taken. If they hadn't compromised, but then what Madison did was very cleverly or very astutely, said there are two wings to the opposition. One who wants to work within the system and would be satisfied with the Bill of Rights, and the other wing wants abolition. Doesn't want to join at all. Is it possible to drive a wedge between those two wings? And Madison drove a wedge right between those two wings in the first Congress, which is why we got a Bill of Rights, rather than an abolition of the Union. I am not as, I mean, if we see compromise as doing the best which is possible, I think you can find a principle on which to defend it. And how would marriages work? Oh, don't ask me that. You have the last word.
I was just going to ask for, forget the Democrats and the Republicans.
Willingly.
Okay. But you have the liberals and you have the conservatives.
Yep. I don't know. This is not something I'm in favor of. But it would seem to me that if the liberals played it straight and asked for an amendment to the Constitution abolishing the Electoral College instead of trying to end run the Electoral College, which is what they're doing, if they play the game straight constitutionally and it gets passed, so it becomes part of the Constitution, a good conservative should say, I lost, but it's part of the Constitution. For example, a lot of my friends do not think the progressive movement, 16th Amendment, 17th, 18th, 19th, 20th, those four amendments, they think they've ruined America, essentially, right? And my point is, if they've ruined America, it hasn't been by subterfuge. They've done it constitutionally. The question is, Think about it. What ruined federalism? What ruined federalism? The 17th Amendment. Why did the 17th Amendment ruin federalism? Because it meant that the states no longer selected the senators for the U.S. Senate. And I say, but think about it. Think about it. In order to get that amendment passed, you had to get two-thirds of the Senate to agree, who had been elected by state legislators. And then you have to get three-quarters of the state legislatures to agree to give up their power. And they did. That's the real question. How did progressivism sweep America constitutionally? I mean, it seems to be so easy for us to find a blame. You know, I don't know. I don't know what it is going to take, but I'm absolutely certain that without civic education, we're done. And that any extra little coins you have, any extra time you have, invest in your schools. Invest in some way in homeschooling. Invest in some way in doing this. Teach your students how to read and write. The self-esteem will come if it ever comes. Now, I'm not preaching bullying. I'm saying that there are certain tasks which we are well equipped to do or should be doing. I will end with this one story which really took me by surprise yesterday. You know, the students, we were talking about Rousseau and equality and how he liked the simple life, Jean-Jacques Rousseau, yeah, liked the simple life, liked the peasant. And some students said, well, you know, that's not exactly an example of his personal life. I said, no, without going into detail, you're absolutely correct. He liked his height of pleasure. Was to be whipped by a naked woman. And so the student said, well, there goes his ideas. I said, well, why? He said, because his personal life doesn't mirror what he says. Therefore, I can dismiss it. I said, well, where do we stop on this thing? I mean, right? Where, I mean, sure, I agree. By the way, I don't agree with his definition of pleasure, nor do I agree with his understanding of, yes, there are certain, but so then I said, well, how about Machiavelli? Machiavelli said, teach evil, deceit, nastiness, and did it. The student said, that's all right because he's honest. And I said, this is something I cannot believe. So as long as I'm honest about it, I can be as nasty and as evil as possible because I'm being honest about it. The real problem is hypocrisy. It's almost like we should rewrite the seven deadly sins and the seven heavenly virtues and put hypocrisy at the core. You know, I bet you didn't want to get that answer. May the blessings of liberty be upon you and your posterity.
I'm Director of Programs with the Ashbrook Center. Proud to have co-sponsored tonight's event, and I just wanted to say a few words of thanks as we close. First of all, thanks again to the Reagan Library, and particularly to Tony Penney and the staff of the Annenberg Center for Presidential Learning here for co-sponsoring another event with us. It's always a pleasure to come out and hear Dr. Lloyd, and I'm grateful for all of the work that your staff put in for this program. Thank you to Rosemary Licata and Beatrice Restifo. These ladies are dynamos. They get an idea in their head and they work until it's done. And this was a fantastic event. Thank you again to Gordon, not only for your time tonight, but for the lifetime that you have spent studying and teaching about the American founding. And Ashbrook is very proud to have partnered with you in these websites, and we're very proud to have partnered with you in the publication of Madison's records of the debates in the convention of 1787. And we're very pleased to announce its publication tonight and very pleased that you're willing to sign copies after the event. So thank you all for being here tonight, and thank you again to Dr. Lloyd.
We have a small gift from the Thousand Oaks Republican Women's Federated, and it was unbelievable tonight. We are so proud. And this is from the Ronald Reagan Library.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I believe that Dr. Lloyd will be able to sign books at this table.
Yeah, we're going to bring the table here. If anybody would like to purchase the book, we have it in the back corner, and you can just line up in this center aisle here. Thank you again for coming this evening, and have a wonderful rest of your Constitution week.